On with unit 3 in this video, and this video is going to focus on learning target 5D, which is about dividing polynomials. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to use synthetic division to factor a polynomial into linear factors, as well as use synthetic division to determine if a factor of x minus b is a factor of p of x or not. So before we get into what synthetic division is, let's have some background for why we're using this and where it comes from. So we're going to take a little trip down memory lane to long division. So if I'm dividing two numbers, here I'm taking 21 and dividing it into 483. 21 is what we call our divisor, and 483 is what we call our dividend. And in long division, our goal is to start reducing terms down. So I'm first trying to figure out, well, how many times does 21 go into the first two terms of 48? And 21 goes into 48 twice. I'm going to put that over the 8. Then when we multiply, we go 21 times 2 to give us 42. We then subtract down, and our goal was to get those 4s to cancel and reduce down to just a single digit there. And so 48 minus 2 gives us 6. Bring down the 3. And so now I'm taking 21 and seeing how many times it goes into 63. 21 goes into 63 three times, so I place a 3 in the next spot over the 1s. 21 times 3 is giving us actually 63 exactly, which when we subtract off, we're left with 0 from there. And now we learned about long division back in elementary school, and what we're going to focus on why we're talking about it is we want that vocabulary that goes with it. So 21 is what we call the divisor, 483 is what we call the dividend. What do we call this number that we get left with when we finish the subtraction? That's called the remainder. And then the other one that we need a term for is the 23. Does anybody remember what the 23 is called? 23 is what we call the quotient. And the reason we're doing a long division problem with just numbers is we're going to actually do this with polynomials. And so there is a correlating concept that's long division with polynomials that we can do as well. So here our divisor is x plus 5, it's that linear factor, and our dividend is 2x squared plus 13x minus 16. And our goal with long division is the same thing that we did up above. We want to slowly start to cancel from the highest down to the lowest. So up here in our original problem when we had numbers, our goal was to cancel as much of the 48 as we could. Same thing here, our goal is to cancel the 2x squared term. So we need to think about what can I multiply x plus 5 by that will get me for sure a 2x squared plus some other stuff. Because we are going to multiply it to not only the x but also the plus 5. Well, we could multiply x plus 5 by a 2x. And since that is a linear term, I'm going to place it over the linear spot here. And when I take 2x and I multiply it to x plus 5, I'm multiplying it to each term. So 2x times x is giving us that 2x squared that we were after. And then 2x times 5 is giving me a plus 10x. From here, we're going to go ahead and subtract it. And the reason I'm putting parentheses around it is because I actually have two terms here that I'm subtracting. And the reason we're subtracting is the same reason we did it in long division up above. So when I subtract 2x squared minus 2x squared, I'm left with no more x squareds, which was the goal. 13x minus 10x is leaving me with a 3x. Now just like we did up above, I'm going to bring down the next term. So I have 3x minus 16 now. Our goal is to cancel that 3x. So what can I multiply x plus 5 by that will get me a 3x plus something else in this spot? Well, I would multiply it by a positive 3. And since we're dealing with polynomials here, and I'm multiplying by a positive number, that's why I'm getting this plus sign in between the 2x and the 3. When we distribute that 3 to the x plus 5, we're getting the 3x, which is exactly what we were after. And then 3 times 5 is giving us 15. Now we're going to subtract this off. The 3x is canceled, which was our goal. I now have negative 16 minus 15, so I'm left with negative 31. There we go. Now, just like up above, this negative 31 is what we call our remainder. And the 2x plus 3 is what we call our quotient. And we're going to be looking at dividing polynomials in this section, And one way to do that is through long division. Now, this is a really cumbersome process to have to do long division on every single polynomial to try to figure out which ones end up working. And that's why we have this concept called synthetic division that we're actually going to use in place of long division. But we needed to talk about long division so that we can review some of these terminologies with the divisor, the dividend, the quotient, and the remainder. And that leads us to our division algorithm. So the division algorithm for polynomials says that if we divide p of x by d of x, so both p of x and d of x are polynomials here, we get a quotient q of x and a remainder r of x. And what would end up happening is that our original polynomial p of x that we started with, and in this example above, this p of x would be the 2x squared plus 13x minus 16 that we have demonstrated down here, that would be equal to the dividend, which is that x plus 5, times our quotient, which is the 2x plus 3, plus our remainder. But here, since our remainder is a negative number, we would just write minus 31 instead. And that represents this original polynomial that we started with is equal to our divisor times our quotient plus our remainder. Same thing worked up above when we just had numbers that we were dealing with. 483 is equal to our divisor of 21 times our quotient of 23 plus our remainder of 0. And we have the same concept that we also have with polynomials. Now the difference between these two examples, not only just that the first one had numbers and the second one now has polynomials, but when we get a remainder that's equal to 0, something special happens. So if our remainder is equal to 0, then p of x is just equal to the divisor times the quotient, since I'm technically just adding plus 0, so that r of x goes away. But more importantly, what that means is that the divisor and the quotient are what we call factors of our polynomial p of x. And in this section, we're interested in figuring out if something is a factor of a polynomial, because our ultimate goal will be to factor a polynomial as much as we possibly can. So let's talk about what synthetic division is. So synthetic division simplifies the long division process, and it does that by getting rid of all the x's, and it only uses numbers. That's what makes it a much simpler process than dealing with the long division. Now, how we do that is we write all the coefficients, including any zero terms. And what I mean by the zero terms is if I'm missing like an x squared or an x term, but I have the other powers around it, then I have to put a zero in place of any term that I'm missing, since the coefficient there would be zero. So we're writing out all the coefficients of the polynomial in standard form, so from highest to lowest power. And for the divisor piece of it, which would be that x minus b, that linear factor, we're going to use the corresponding zero of b. So let's look at our first example. We're going to use synthetic division to divide x cubed minus 14x squared plus 51x minus 54 by x plus 2. We will then state the quotient and the remainder. So the first piece we start off with is our divisor, so the x plus 2. I'm going to use the corresponding 0, which would be a negative 2, and I'm going to put a little half box around it, just to separate it from my coefficients of my polynomial. From here, I'm going to list my coefficients of my polynomial in standard form. So for the x cubed term, I have a coefficient of 1. For the x squared term, I have a coefficient of negative 14. And I'm giving myself a little space in between these so that I can signify each different number. Then for my x term, I have a positive 51. And for my constant term, I have that negative 54. So since I have a cubic that I'm starting with, I have to have a coefficient for the cubic, the x squared, the x, and the constant term. From here, I want to leave an entire line, and then I'm going to draw just a horizontal bar from there. But I have this blank space in between because we are going to fill that in with some numbers. So this is going to be our setup for synthetic division. We flip the sign on our factor to write the corresponding 0, so that's where the negative 2 is coming from. And then we list all of our coefficients of our polynomial in standard form. Now from here, the first thing we do in any synthetic division problem is we bring down that first coefficient. So I'm just going to bring down the 1, and I'm writing an arrow there just to remind myself that I'm bringing that down. Now from here, the process or the algorithm starts to happen. What we do is that we take the number down here that I brought down. So I'm taking this 1. I'm going to multiply it to the negative 2. So 1 times negative 2 is giving me a negative 2. And I'm going to write that number in the next spot underneath the negative 14. From here, I'm going to add down. So negative 14 plus a negative 2 is giving us a negative 16. And then I would repeat the process again. I'll take the negative 16 now. I'll multiply it to the negative 2. That's going to give us a positive 32. And that's going to go in the next spot. Now I add down. So 51 plus 32 is going to give us 83. And I continue the process one more time until I finish off with the last row. So I take 83 times the negative 2. I get negative 166. Now I add down, so negative 54 plus negative 166 is going to give us a negative 220. And I know I'm done now once I finish off that last row from there. And I'm going to just kind of box off this last number because it's going to actually be an important term for us. So the synthetic division process, just to repeat it again, we write our corresponding 0. I just do a little half box just to separate it from the coefficients of the polynomial, which I then write in this first row right here. I bring down the first term, then I take that term, which would be 1 times the negative 2. I place that number in the next spot over, so 1 times negative 2 is giving us a negative 2. We then add directly down, so negative 14 plus a negative 2 is giving us a negative 16. Then we repeat the process. Negative 16 times that negative 2 is giving us a positive 32. Write that in the next spot. Add down. 51 plus 32 is giving us 83. We repeat the process one more time. 83 times negative 2 is giving us negative 166. We add down. Negative 54 plus negative 166 is giving us a negative 220. Now that we've completed the synthetic division process, let's talk about what information this gives us. Well, the reason I boxed off this last number is that last number is actually our remainder. And then the other three coefficients that are left over, or the other three numbers that are left over, are going to become the coefficients on our quotient. So here I have a 1, a negative 16, and an 83. And they're going from highest to lowest coefficient in standard form. Now we started off with an x cubed, and I divided through by a linear term. So if I take an x cubed and I divide through by a single x, I'm going to be left with an x squared then. So that means that this first number of 1 is going to be our coefficient on an x squared term. Then the negative 16 is going to be our coefficient on our x to the first power. And our last term is that constant term, which is a positive 83. Just fix that. So since we dropped down a power when we divided through by that linear term of x plus 2, that's why our highest power now is an x squared. That also matches up with the fact that I only have 3 coefficients, so that matches an x squared, the x term, and then the constant term. So our quotient is x squared minus 16x plus 83, and then our remainder, if I'm going to list it out, is going to be equal to negative 220. And that is what the synthetic division process allows us to find. Let's look at our next example. So we're going to use synthetic division to divide x cubed minus 57x plus 56 by x minus 7. And again, we want to state the quotient and the remainder. Let's get enough space here. So we'll start the same process. So the first thing I need to do is find my corresponding 0. So for x minus 7, what would our corresponding 0 be? So our corresponding 0 is going to be positive 7. I'm going to put a little half box around it. And next, I'm going to list all of my coefficients out. So why don't you guys pause the video and list out all of your coefficients for every single term. So our first coefficient is off the x cubed term, which is going to be a 1. Now my next term is actually missing. I also need to have that x squared spot represented. But since I have no x squared term in my polynomial, I'm going to place a 0 there. Then my next term is the x term, which has a coefficient of negative 57. Then my last term is my constant term. So this is one of those cases where when I said up above, we want to make sure that we include any zeros. Since I don't have an x squared term, that's technically a 0 times the x squared. So that's why I'm placing a 0 in the x squared spot. From here, I'm going to leave myself a line and then just draw a horizontal bar to represent what we end up finding later on as our quotient. So our first step again, bring down that first number, which happens to be a 1 again. And now from here, we can start this algorithm. So I'm going to take the first number here of 1, multiply to the 0, which would be 7. 1 times 7 is giving us 7. That will go in the next spot. We then add down. 0 plus 7 is going to give us 7. And then we repeat the process again. Why don't you guys pause the video right here and finish out the synthetic division. So our next step would be to take 7 down here times the 7 to give us 49. We'll add down in this column. Negative 57 plus 49 is going to give us negative 8. One more time, we'll take negative 8 times 7. That will give us negative 56. And then 56 plus negative 56 is going to end us up with 0. And I'm done because I have filled in all the rows now. Now that we've finished off our synthetic division, I want to find the quotient and the remainder. Our quotient is going to come from these first three numbers, the 1, 7, and negative 8. And then our remainder is that last number that we ended up with. Why don't you guys pause the video right here and write out what the quotient would be, and as well as what the remainder is. So for our quotient, since I started with an x cubed and I divided through by a linear term again, I'm going to end up with a highest power of x squared. So I'm going to get a 1x squared, or just x squared, plus 7x minus 8. And our remainder is always that last number, which is equal to 0. Now there's a big difference between these two examples because of what the remainder ended up being. In our first example here, we got a remainder that was not equal to 0. And what that means then, according to the division algorithm, is that x plus 2 is not a factor of this polynomial. Versus, in example 2, since our remainder was equal to 0, that tells us that x minus 7 is a factor of this original polynomial that we started with. And we're going to use that concept in our next couple examples. So in example 3, we're asking ourselves the question, is x minus 3 a factor of f of x here, which is x to the fifth minus 2x cubed minus x squared plus 2? And then explain. If it is, we want to write it as a product of two factors as well. Well, this is not telling us directly to use synthetic division, but we can use synthetic division to figure out what's going on. And our goal is to see what our remainder ends up being. So let's start by setting up our synthetic division. Why don't you guys pause the video here and set up your synthetic division for example 3. So to set this up, x minus 3, the corresponding 0 to that would be positive 3. I'm going to then list all of my coefficients. I'm now starting with an x to the fifth, so I'm going to have quite a few more coefficients here. That guy has a 1 as its coefficient. My next term would be an x to the fourth, which is missing, so I'm going to put a 0 in its place, since that is our coefficient there for missing a term. My next term down is that x cubed, which is a negative 2 as the coefficient. Then the x squared is a negative 1. Then our linear term, which would just be a single x, is also missing. So that gets a 0, and then we get our constant term here. I'm going to leave a space and then put that horizontal bar. So this is our setup for synthetic division. Now from here, I'm going to actually start doing the synthetic division. So I drop down that first number. Then I take that first number of 1 times 3, place it in the next spot. Then I add down. 0 plus 3 is giving me 3. Then we repeat the process again. Why don't you guys pause the video and finish out your synthetic division, and then we'll check it together at the end. So to check this, I'm going to take 3 times that 3. We'll get 9. Add down. I get positive 7. 7 times 3 is giving us 21. If we add down here, negative 1 plus 21 is giving us 20. And then we take 20 times 3 and we get 60. If we add down, 0 plus 60 is just going to give us 60. Then to finish off, 60 times 3 is giving us 180. And when we add down, we end up with 182 then. I'm going to box that off because, as we learned before, this last number is giving us our remainder. So what do you guys think? If we ended up with a remainder here of 182, is x minus 3 going to be a factor of f of x? So no, in this case, x minus 3 is not a factor of our original polynomial f of x, since we got a remainder that is not equal to 0. Oops. And so when we're asked to justify or explain, we need to explain our logic behind it. And since it's all based off of our remainder, and our remainder here was 182, which does not equal to 0, then x minus 3 is not going to be a factor of f of x. Now, just for practice, I do want us to practice writing out our quotient just so that we get familiar with it. And this time, we got to pay close attention to the polynomial we started with. We started with an x to the fifth, and we divided out by a single x term, or a linear term. That leaves us with x to the fourth as our highest power. So these coefficients of 1, 3, 7, 20, and 60 are going to start off with an 1x to the fourth plus a 3x cubed then, since I take now the next power, plus 7x squared plus 20x, and then plus our constant term of 60. So we have to keep in mind that it's not just always going to be the same power we start off with. It's based off of what our power was that we began with, and we drop down one power since we divided through by a linear term then. Okay, let's look at example 4. We're asked, is x plus 4 a factor of g of x? And we want to explain. If it is, we'll write g of x as a product of two factors. So why don't you guys set up the synthetic division, and then we'll check that together. So our synthetic division setup is going to have a negative 4, since that's the corresponding 0 to the factor of x plus 4. And when I list out our coefficients, our highest power is that x to the 5th with a 1. Then we have a negative 3 with the x to the 4th. Then we have negative 28 with the x cubed. But then the x squared term is missing, so that's getting a 0. And then we have a 5 and then a 20 for our linear and constant terms. Now from here, we can do the synthetic division. Why don't you guys pause the video and finish off the synthetic division on your own? So our first step, bring down that 1. 1 times negative 4 is giving us a negative 4. If we add down, we end up with a negative 7. Negative 7 times negative 4 is giving us a positive 28. So when we add down, I end up with 0. 0 times negative 4 is going to give me 0. 0 plus 0 is giving me 0. 0 times negative 4 is again giving me another 0. But now when I add down, 5 plus 0 is giving me 5. 5 times negative 4 is giving me, negative 20 then. When we add those down, we end up with one last 0 then. So here, what is our remainder this time? So in this example, our remainder is going to be equal to 0. So does that mean that we have a factor, that x plus 4 is a factor, or is x plus 4 not a factor? So in this case, yes, x plus 4 is a factor of our original polynomial g of x. And our reasoning is since our remainder is equal to 0. And it says that if it is a factor, we want to write g of x as a product of two factors. Well, what that means is that in our division algorithm, if we were to look back at the first page of our notes, we could write our original function g of x as our divisor of x plus 4 times our quotient then. So our next step we have to do is figure out what that quotient is. So using these coefficients, why don't you guys write out what the quotient polynomial will be? So since we started with an x to the fifth power and I divided through by a linear term, I'm left with an x to the fourth as my highest power. So we get 1x to the fourth minus 7x cubed. Now for the zeros, that means I technically get plus 0x squared and then plus a 0x and then plus that constant term of 5. Now down below, I'm not going to write out the terms that have a zero. Those are pretty silly to write out. So our quotient will be, if I simplify it down, it's going to be x to the fourth minus 7x cubed plus 5 then. Oops, parentheses. And this would be what g of x would look like in factored form. So our goal eventually is to be able to factor any polynomial down to all linear terms. And in this section, what we're looking at is if I do synthetic division once, I drop down a power from here. In the next couple examples, what we're going to look at is what if I continue to do synthetic division, or if I do synthetic division once and I end up with a quadratic, then I could actually factor that quadratic just like we did in our last unit. So let's look at example 5. It says use synthetic division to factor p of x completely. And we're going to start by dividing p of x by x plus 1. So they're telling us that x plus 1 should be a factor. And so we just need to do synthetic division to verify that and then to find the quotient polynomial. So why don't you guys set up the synthetic division for dividing p of x by x plus 1. So to check that, we'd have negative 1 as our corresponding 0 to x plus 1. P of x, I'm going to have a 1, 2, a negative 19, and a negative 20 if we list all of the coefficients there. So this would be our setup for synthetic division. Why don't you guys pause the video and do the synthetic division for this example. So the first thing we do is drop down that first coefficient, which is a 1. Then we take that number and we multiply. 1 times negative 1 is giving us a negative 1. We then add down. 2 minus 1 is giving us 1, and I continue the process. So 1 times negative 1 is a negative 1. Negative 19 plus a negative 1 is giving us negative 20. Negative 20 times a negative 1 is giving us a positive 20, which if we add down, we get left with 0 then, which is what we expected. We expected our remainder here to be equal to 0 since our goal is to factor this polynomial completely. Now from here, we can use these coefficients to list our quotient polynomial. So why don't you guys list out what the quotient polynomial would be? So that quotient polynomial, since we started with an x cubed and we divided out by a linear term, we're going to be left with an x squared then as our highest power. So we're getting 1x squared plus x minus 20. And using the division algorithm, since our remainder was equal to 0, then we know that x plus 1 is a factor. And that means that our original polynomial we can write as x plus 1 times that quotient polynomial of x squared plus x minus 20. Now that we've taken this cubic and rewritten it as a product of a linear term times the quadratic, well, we can use stuff from our last unit to continue to factor that quadratic from there. So why don't you guys pause the video and factor the x squared plus x minus 20. And if you need to, feel free to use an X Games to do so. So let's check our factoring. We're looking for two numbers that multiply to be negative 20 and add up to be positive 1. That would be negative 4 and positive 5. So our factors then would be x minus 4 and x plus 5. And we have factored p of x completely here since we're left with only linear terms. Let's look at example number 6. We want to use synthetic division to factor f of x completely, and they're telling us to start by dividing f of x by this x minus 6. So again, why don't you guys set up the synthetic division for example 6, and then we'll check the setup together. So for our setup, our factor of x minus 6 has that corresponding 0 of positive 6. We list the coefficients. We'll have 1, a 7, a negative 38, and a negative 240. And I have no zeros in either of these two examples since I had a term for every single power. This would be our setup for our synthetic division. Why don't you guys now pause the video and complete the synthetic division for example 6. So in our first step, we bring down that first number, then we multiply that number times 6 to get positive 6. We add down, 7 plus 6 is giving us 13. We can continue the process. So 13 times 6 is going to give us 78. Now, negative 38 plus 78 is going to give us 40 then. 40 times 60 is going to give us a positive 240. And if we add those down, we end up with 0, which is what we thought we should get, since that means that since our remainder is equal to 0, that x minus 6 is a factor. Now from here, we want to write out our polynomial f of x as a factored form completely. Why don't you guys pause the video and decide on what your quotient is going to be using these coefficients. Now, since we started with an x cubed and I divided through by a single x term, we're left with an x squared then. So we get 1x squared plus 13x plus 40 as our quotient. And what that tells us is that since our remainder is equal to 0, then again, x minus 6 is a factor. So we can rewrite f of x as that x minus 6 times our quotient of x squared plus 13x plus 40. And our last step from here is now that we're down to a quadratic, we can factor this just like we did in our last unit. So why don't you guys pause the video here and factor the x squared plus 13x plus 40, and we'll check that together. So if I set up an x games for it, we're looking for two numbers that multiply to be 40 and add up to be positive 13. The two numbers that are going to work is going to be positive 5 and positive 8, which means we get x plus 5 as a factor, as well as x plus 8. And that would be our complete factored form then for this polynomial f of x. So in this section, we learned about a very important tool called synthetic division, where we're able to divide any polynomial by a linear potential factor. If our remainder ends up being 0, then it means that that factor was indeed a factor for our polynomial. If we get a remainder that's not equal to 0, then that linear term is not a factor. Once we figure out which ones are factors, we can then actually continue to factor from here. And we're going to use this tool in the rest of this unit. And in our next section, we're going to actually learn how to kind of narrow down what our potential factors could be and how we could strategically find them. So in this video, in examples 5 and 6, I gave us a factor that would work. So in example 6, I knew x minus 6 would work. And in our next section, what we're going to look at is, well, if I don't have that given information, how can I kind of figure out a list of potential options that could work and then start checking from there?